Welcome to the 7th episode of the Liberate LRVA Couched series, in which we talk about everything anarchy and voluntarist from the perspective of integrity, virtues, and ethics, of course. Presenting the discussion group to the left, we have
Rachel Renner, who's fairly bursting with integrity, virtues, and ethics.
Gotcha. And to the right of her,
Bugatti.
And to my right,
Tyler.
Here's on Flores.
And Molinet. So with that, we're going to begin our first topic on the custom everyone's list that we're talking about out there right now, body cams. There's a lot of people who feel that, you know, it'll be great and advocating police accountability and transparency so that we can rein in these violent sociopaths.
And GoPros are super cute.
Right? Yeah, absolutely. And so what they fail to consider is that, you know, you're still going to have to rob from people to support those, to fund them, right? These are still status solutions, these are still political solutions, and people very easily forget that there exists no factual evidence that voting reforms or politics has ever achieved freedom. None. You know, the fact that we're talking about this today implies that every single attempt in the past to control government, restrain it, create accountability and transparency, and to rein in the Leviathan has failed. And so the fact that we're born as tax slaves implies that every political attempt to achieve freedom through government has failed. So, but that's something that most people could rationally understand. The ones I find to have contention with it would be some statists of denial, some libertarians with a capital L. So political libertarians, I guess in that regards. But before we go more into those viewpoints, you want to start off? Anything? What are your thoughts on body cams, Tyler?
So it was an effort at
he's
police.
Always on the spot.
All right, police accountability. We covered this, Eric Garner. It was in August. Man strangled to death over selling cigarettes, and no one was indicted, which was good for, I guess, the guy who strangled.
Right.
But that's an illegal move.
Yeah, Daniel Patello.
And now a lot of people are mad. And I wonder, like, would this story be where it is now if it wasn't for, like, Ferguson and Brown? Like, I feel like there's a narrative here, and the media is hyping it up.
Right.
It's crazy. I don't watch mainstream television.
Yeah, it's interesting. So they had they already had video evidence of this person being murdered by a cop. Murdered by Danielle Pantaleo and murdering Eric Garner on camera, video evidence of this. And it went to an indictment process, and he was not charged at all. The jury just didn't pay attention to the evidence. I was hearing the case from the camera guy's perspective, because it's him they indicted for charges. The person who actually did the recording got indicted. The person who actually murdered someone did not.
That's BS.
Isn't it? Yeah.
Has anybody weighed in on the cigarette aspect? I mean, we're living here in Richmond, and it's common knowledge that people come down from New England to, you know, Philip Morris Central to buy cigarettes in bulk and take them back up just because the prices get so exorbitant the closer you get to New York. So, you know, this guy's, you know, taking on the entrepreneurial spirit and selling single cigarettes to feed people's addiction, you know, and is, you know, arrested for it. And ultimately, you know, slaughtered for it, you know. So yeah, it's kind of a nice little corporatism trigger right there. That, oh, is it so goddamn illegal that somebody had to die for it?
Well, they're talking about the government's monopoly on tobacco.
Right, and it's supposed to have a monopoly on alcohol.
And then they choose to give it to some companies.
But, right. Yeah.
Like, there's so many hoops you have to pass. Like, unless you're already the established companies who they have, mm-hmm. who do tobacco, the big companies like Philip Morris, now Altria. There's so many regulations on the testing. There's a lot of things you got to get past before, like, you even start getting anything to market. So if you're already in the game, you've got the whole market, which is why it is the way it is now. They're the only guys who, like, make anything.
Yeah, it's very cheap down here, down south, to buy, and a lot of people run them up to New York City, and a lot of people get caught here trying to get up there on 95, unfortunately. And they're now considering raising sin taxes here in Virginia on cigarettes, of course. Saying, well, look at the other tax farms. You know, their cigarette extortion rates are pretty high. Ours is comparably low, so maybe we should raise them up and, you know, fund our other unsustainable monopolies. But yeah, I do think that should also be taken into consideration. Not so much in the degree that there's some kind of politician who's saying he's trying to blame his death on cigarettes themselves or cigarette tax distractor. Forget the cop murder here. No, actually, that's what happened. it was a victimless crime.
But that's the rationale. If they had had a body cam right there, I'd been like, oh, you know, he was. First of all, he was, you know, defying the revenue generating sources of, you know, New York City all along the Eastern Seaboard, arguably right to our, you know, tax farm here. And, you know, so there wasn't anything really wrong with what I did. You can film it all you want. If it's illegal, they can still kill you.
I mean,
that's what it boils down to.
And that's so much like they already know sometimes that they're already being recorded in their dash cams. And so sometimes they'll just go out of the frame. Sometimes they'll make the announcement that, you know, put down the weapon, stop resisting, even though the person's not resisting. So they'll find a sneakier way to go around it. Maybe have your partner be in front of you, in front of the dash cam, you know, different ways to kind of block it. Or they'll just commit their heinous acts when they're off duty. People forget and think that cops only do this while they're wearing the costume. And that they're angels when they're not wearing it when they go back
home. I love
how
you call it the costume.
that's a contention that I think should be kind of closely examined. People want to look for quick, easy solutions, and I don't think there are none. There's not going to be an easy, quick solution to push up a paper. Obama, the political ruler of presidents, calling for 50,000 body cameras to be given to police extortionists, and a lot of status and denials out there are advocating for that in support, which is kind of weird. Because I make the comparison that advocating for body cams for police extortion is akin to providing rapists with condoms. And even worse, as Christoph mentioned earlier, was that the rape victim is being forced to pay for those condoms for the rapist to wear. And as much the victims of those extortionists, of being the extortion victims, are being forced to pay for those body cams just to have a sigvoristic view of the attack. And not that it's going to end extortion. I mean, people forget that when they pull you over on the highway for a victimless crime because of your tail light's not missing, you didn't proper turn signals, or those are extortion stops, right? They're all extortion. It's not going to stop extortion stops. It's not going to stop the encounter. It's just one of those false senses of hope that people have, a misdirection, and that the real fight, the real way to achieve this would be turning away from government, turning away from all that commits crime. They forget that government itself are full of murderers and thieves and rapists. Let's not turn to those people for a solution. So that's the Eric Garner thing. Do you have anything you want to add into that? No? No? So I guess we could wrap that up. I mean, it shouldn't be that difficult to contend with. You know, you're not going to find salvation through government. You're not going to find it through politics. It's never worked. It's never been achieved. And I think it's a misdirection. Sleight of hand move to keep you thinking that government can still keep you safe when they're the ones who are creating these unsafe environments to begin with. The next topic we have is UK government decides what is consensual in porn.
I don't think it's deciding what is consensual, right? Because they even said even if these actions are consensual, they're limiting what can be shown.
Right, but they don't really provide a rationale. From their point of view, they're saying this is what's permitted, this is what can be considered.
Yeah, but they're not really talking about consensuality, right?
Well,
they're saying what consensuality is.
Well, there is no consent.
I think it's a question of
you.
Decency, not consensuality. This is what I read.
There's no consent from you and the government.
No, they're not trying to regulate.
Well, yeah, I would, yes, they are.
What they're saying is what you can and can't show on camera. That's what they're saying. They're not saying... Because they even said in one of the actions that's banned, even if this action is consensual, you're not allowed to show it. So it's not that like they're saying all these actions are not consensual. Because they're still acknowledging that they are consensual, but you're just not allowed to show them.
Well, I'm trying to point out the hypocrisy of it, that they're trying
right.
to say, because they're involving themselves in these areas that are consensual and limiting the lifestyles of these people.
I don't think they're saying
they're
non-consensual.
They're banning these stuff.
I know, but they're not saying they're non-consensual, though.
Yeah, no, but the banning of it is...
Banning of it is not consensual.
Yeah.
So
but they're not saying these sex acts are...
It doesn't matter what they say. They're going to say whatever they want to say.
Just what you said.
Yeah.
Well, I'm talking about it objectively.
I know what you said made it sound like they were saying these sex acts were...
Well,
I'm
providing a good objective discussion on what it is they're exactly doing. I'm saying that they're showing hypocrisy with it. I mean, you didn't read the article.
Rewind
backwards. She didn't read the article, so I'm going to go and discuss it for her. So she's going to think about it, but you guys can read it for yourself. So
she
I'm saying
a fair amount about porn, trust me.
Dude, it's about what you just said.
Right, and I'm saying it's hypocritical that these people want to get themselves involved in what is considered consent or non-consent.
That's not what you said. Preamble to the Daily Mail.
The preamble, yeah. So an amendment to the 2003 Communications Act announced new censors aimed at what kind of porn can be produced. There has been a long-time advocacy group in England in trying to... turn back porn, trying to cut it down, trying to repeal it, trying to avert the eyes of people in the UK and the internet and viewing porn.
And it should be noted, before the internet even came about in one of the UK's, you know, standards of culture, their call boxes, you know, not the blue police one with the Doctor Who stuff, but the red one that the public uses, those things were lined with pamphlets for call girls. I mean, that was part of, like, the pop culture thing that you found there. Like, you know, call this person and she'll talk dirty to you about X, Y, and Z. You know, I mean, this is not a new thing to pop up in UK culture with the advent of the internet. Just throwing that out there, you know. And, but sorry, go on.
No, please. No, absolutely. You know, so there's a ban now on what kind of porn you can produce of consensual acts. And the ban that these include are spanking.
Which the UK is known for, corporal punishment.
Right.
The stern governess thing that is huge with them.
It's interesting that they want to go immediately to, like, you can't spank each other in these adult produced films, but they're not going to look and examine what about the hitting of children in that particular part of spanking. You know, we're going to go into the other minute areas of distraction and not focus on a lot of the stuff that is going on right now. And I find that to be kind of interesting. Like, turnaround is like you have the bullseye right in front of you, but you rather throw the darts all around it instead of heading for some of the real.
Yeah, and that addresses the fact, why do adults like this? Are they trying to deal with something that happened to them as children?
Right? Yeah. Why? Another one would be caning.
Caning. So is that like when you hit someone with a cane?
Yes.
Or
a long. I don't know why they have that separate from spanking, you know, because there's thuddy, there's stingy, there's just different.
I don't understand why they.
That's probably what it is, like a foreign object type thing.
It's
because
like,
foreign objects come into play later.
So yeah, so don't hit people with your pimp cane.
Gosh. It's a pimp cane, right?
But what if they, like, that's what...
Because you might smudge it.
What about a paddle?
That would probably be, this, it would just be probably using a tool to spank someone.
So this stuff is kind of already reminding me of in 1984 with the anti-sex leaks and the bans on a lot of the things that can be produced.
Well, they narrow it down to just breeding-centric behavior,
right.
Which... fills the tax form.
Yeah.
This is fetish. This is transference. This is people gaining sexual satisfaction without having to engage in intercourse, and that's a threat to the state.
Right.
Sorry, please come.
No, please. And because I like to relate it to like the same thing that's going on in Japan. But we'll jump into that one next.
Like, oh no, we don't want sexual deviance. But what's normality? What is there normalness to deviate from? Maybe it's just human expression. They don't care.
Aggressive whipping.
This is what Cromwell would want people in the UK. What the fuck are you doing?
Aggressive weapon.
Oliver Cromwell.
You have physical restraint. It's interesting. It's like, look, a lot of the stuff seems already what their own police extortionists do to people, so why don't you ban that, right?
Oh, yeah, they're not allowed to have guns. They only have truncheons. Thump, thump, thump,
right.
Thump, thump.
So in this factual, consensual world where adults have safe words, adults are participating in consensual kinky activities, in the fantasy world they want to ban, but in the real world, I guess the places that are non-consensual, you know, they just want to overlook that and say these are the areas where there's physical restraint, humiliation, aggressive whipping, and spanking going on. And the next one would be humiliation, female ejaculation.
Wait,
it doesn't happen.
You can't have female ejaculation. They've banned female ejaculation from porn.
Male ejaculation is okay.
I think you probably can't just see it.
Oh my god!
I mean, it can happen. Squirting, yeah. Which?
Oh, okay.
They haven't banned the male money shot though.
What the hell?
Right.
Like that's so
won't.
Like that's so sexist.
Yep.
Like oh,
same.
A girl can't ejaculate, but a guy can during porn.
Negative
like,
well, can't versus isn't allowed to, you know.
Right.
So lucky few females who can ejaculate visibly. But, you know.
Right. That sucks. Now it's like, no, now there's no hope that you will enjoy doing porn.
If you get into it professionally, it's a great gimmick to have.
So it's interesting because
but
then, of course...
If you do anything and you're weird enough, it could be a gimmick.
Yes.
No.
That's like saying
God
that
bless
Drake
the internet.
Like, he was so lucky to have like deformities because they could turn them into like money.
The
some
little,
people like, you know, different bro.
Right,
different
like the girl with two heads from...
American Horror.
Exactly.
Or the
she
little tiny girl
money.
From India. I'm glad she found a gig. I think that's pretty cool.
They're so lucky.
so lucky.
The female ejaculation one is interesting because you know that harps a lot with feminism, and they think that males are just like, no, this is a government. This is a racist, discriminatory.
Well, as they point out in the article, this is all femdom oriented. This is, you know, having power with things other than a penis.
Right? Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, nothing here says against male ejaculation, just female ejaculation. The money shots, okay, guys. Face sitting, right? Yeah, absolutely. That could be empowering for females, I imagine.
I'm pretty sure dudes can face it too.
I'm very sure they could. Mm. But face sitting is usually in regards to females in general.
Well,
it's usually accompanied with smothering, which I think is on the list. Or is strangulation or smothering?
Strangulation is on the list.
Strangulation is on the list, but not smothering. Mm.
Right?
Okay.
Unless it's you're a New York City cop wearing a costume, strangulation is okay.
Seriously.
Oh, snap.
Right, but.
Wait, do we know if English cops do that?
Strangle people?
Chokehold?
I don't know if they do the chokehold.
Did we just see the guy do it?
They can have
pepper
spray
in a
British.
Not New York.
NYPD.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'll have to look into that. I'm pretty sure they have their own incidences.
Yeah, they've had police for a long time. They probably have a lot of like bad.
Well, they started like the first monopoly in security with the Metropolitan Police Act with the Bobbies. It was Sir Arthur. I forgot his last name.
Sir Arthur the State.
Too many people are knighted. We can't keep them straight.
Oh man! And then that example of monopolizing security was because before they had night watching, there was private security and such there. And then they look at this kind of private security. It's like, well, we want in on the two, and then they created their own police force. So you have fisting also on the list. Fisting. Fisting.
Another threat to the penis.
Right. So I think this is interesting in these fantastical worlds. Where, I guess, in these kinky environments, you have the freedom to give consent and withdraw that consent anytime you want. It should be an exemplary example of how all communities should be like, you know, the freedom to disassociate between consenting and voluntary relationships. And it's funny how they want to control that last Roman aspect in which this stuff can be founded versus the world that they live in which every decision they make and every interaction with others is non-consensual. There's no safer for government. You have no freedom to disassociate. And I find that to be the place that the attention should be looked at instead.
And doesn't socialized medicine society, and they're undoubtedly going to argue with a lot of these things, that personal safety is involved, but what are you going to argue next? That bukkake is not, you know, OSHA compliant because it makes the floor slippery? Are you going to argue that, you know, BBWs, Big Beautiful Women, not Bed Bath & Body Works, are, you know, in promoting, you know, adult onset diabetes? You know, I mean, it comes down to a Lysander Spooner conundrum that, you know, vices are not crimes.
Yeah.
We want to indulge, and this is indulgence.
I think Bitcoin has done some interesting things in helping a lot of these people in their particular career field that they want to pursue in this sort of stuff. You can now, a lot of these porn sites accept Bitcoin. Someone's found a way now to tip strippers using Bitcoin, so they have like the cameras all over the place, and you can go online and watch their all the cameras around the places there and get Bitcoins, and they'll just shower dollars on the strippers. Yeah. So, escorts are accepting Bitcoin. So, you know, using real sound money and, you know, freedom of privacy in regards to this sort of anonymity sorts of activities. I think Wendy McRae also did an interesting research study herself a couple years ago, looking into the environments to see whether these females involved in the porn industry were being physically abused and such, and she didn't really find much of evidence of that. On the contrary, she found an overabundance and over precautions and over internal regulations to prevent those sort of things from occurring. I'll have like a link, and you guys can watch that later.
The most self-possessed people I know are in the adult industry. The ladies you do not want to fuck with in a bar setting are in the adult industry.
So that's UK. A lot of fucked up going on here. I think here in Virginia, in the tax from Virginia, I think sodomy, not sodomy, anal sex.
It's still called sodomy, even if you do it, if a guy does it with a girl.
Yeah, that's right, even if it was consensual.
Like, because, apparently ass sex is sodomy, so. Okay.
You can't make babies with it.
I think oral sex is also illegal.
That's what it is, yeah.
You know,
still,
so
oral sex is still sodomy.
It's still illegal to have sex in Virginia with the lights on.
Right?
What?
Yes.
Turn them all in.
Is this made before or after the advent of electricity?
Right?
It's still illegal. No, it's still like a thing that can be enforced technically.
Well, I just wonder if we get die on like a space pig clause here, you know? I mean,
in the military,
electric,
I think it's illegal to have sex in any other position but the missionary position. But I'm like, how would you guys find out? Who's going to turn themselves in?
I thought that was your job.
Right? So that's that. Again, you'll never have a safer from government actions. The next thing we have here is...
let's do Krampus, since we're talking about... Yeah.
Since we're in the season now of...
caning and whipping.
Fantasy and reality. I think it's very prudent for parents to help the child understand the difference between the two. Separate, as we talked about earlier, abstract and concrete concepts. Unless their child grows up to believe that government is good, that the police are here to protect you, and the social contract is a real document. So, what do you have to say about Krampus, Rachel?
Ooh, well, I had a beautifully illustrated children's book as a child that told me all about Krampus and had this, like, watercolor thing of the Krampus, you know, descending upon the children and all. And then later on, Venture Brothers had a mild piece on it, too, on one of their holiday specials. And after that, I started hearing about it everywhere, you know, and... hipster conundrum, you know, do I feel really good about this thing I thought was really cool, everybody knows about it now, or am I resentful that I knew about it from the beginning? But yeah, it's still with countries that celebrate St. Nicholas Day, which was this past week, instead of, you know, like now in the U.S. where we have the Coca-Cola Santa and the pop, you know, the Christmas the 25th thing, and, you know, Santa is a separate entity from St. Nicholas and all that shit. But Krampus... Much like what I've talked about with, you know, the portrayal of Nazis and all, Krampus needs to be taken to the realm of the farce. Krampus is the entity that punishes bad children through either abducting them in a sack or beating them severely to make them atone for their sins for the past years. So now we have in the U.S. Krampus walks, which are kind of like the later season version of zombie walks, you know, mm-hmm. an excuse for people to go out in public and be scary and weird and shit. But they've been going on pretty popular in European countries, and they've pretty much gone to the point of like a public spectacle. People get to look scary and dance around and all that shit. But they no longer, you know, actually go out and have people come to your homes and attack your children and all that shit. So it's
cool.
Yeah.
It's taken the idea that is a bad idea, and
that's
do
cool.
it to be funny now. You know,
it's
like
satire.
Wonder Woman. Wonder Woman, Indiana Jones. That's where you see Nazis now, and you know, Krampus. Now you see Krampus in public parades being entertaining, like a, you know, a jester or something. You know, you no longer actually have those ideals, and I'm glad of that. I'm glad that's what we've reduced the idea of a Krampus to.
Well, I guess you could say that government didn't like competition, so they passed the kidnapping children down to CPS. Right. Or public schools.
You smoke marijuana, we're going to take them away.
All right. Yeah, you're homeschooling that
die
kid.
Die in a foster home.
Yeah, I'm going to tase your dad and pepper spray your mom and take that kid away from you. Those couple are suing, finally. So it's an interesting background story with Santa Claus. So you used to have a partner. Ready to go around with.
Oh, Santa had a couple of partners that aren't quite PC now.
Wait, right. Really?
Well, I mean, you've watched The Office. You've seen the whole Smart Peter thing. Yeah.
What?
Santa used to have slaves.
Well, elaborate.
Yeah. Dave Sedaris has talked about this. They talked about it on that episode of The Office where Dwight's brother was going to come in blackface, you know. Santa Claus has... Like most entities that have been around for, you know, a couple of centuries, he's done some things that aren't quite politic, you know? But once again, you know, he's a system of bribery and threats, you know? I mean, he's been used by the powers that be to promote their views. And when it comes right down to it, he is the spirit of gigiving, you know? Don't get me wrong. Santa Claus is a great fucking concept if you can cut away the fat... of the state. Much like most religions, you know?
Well, that's most of Santa Claus.
Yeah, Santa Claus is mostly fat.
Except
yeah.
we do like capitalism.
Yeah,
right?
And no, go out and buy stuff and go out and, you know, enjoy and, you know, give, be nice to each other, but...
Yeah, it's all about, it's like a potlatch, you know, you give, I give, we show off how good we are at giving and how smart I am to give you this gift, and it's a great fucking season, it boosts businesses. I have no problem with Christmas, even as an atheist, but Santa has done, or Santa has been framed as being kind of an asshole.
I know.
Santa not only worked with Krampus, Santa at one point owned slaves. You know, there's a great Dave Sedaris monologue about this. It's been on This American Life, NPR people, you know, you should know about it. Panzer, who isn't here.
There's also rare exports, if you want to know how they actually catch Santa Clauses and produce them out there in mass. you need a tranquilizer gun, you need to have your wits about you. Bringing some snipers teams with you as well to capture a Santa Claus.
Oh, and there's ways you can lure and enrage him with profanity.
Yeah. Gingerbread cookies.
You
know,
he's, he's entirely a reflection of, like, Western culture, though. So if he owns slaves, it's because that was the ideals of Western culture.
Yeah.
What about in Europe? What was his idea then?
I feel like for a lot
Against Christianity, then.
I feel for a lot of Christendom in the Anglo Saxon type, like descendants from Europe, very much like the end of the season holidays, end of the year holidays are always like, oh, what we like want to be having. So yeah, he's gonna be the kind of personification throughout the ages of what that generation thought was the good thing to do, or like the awesome thing to do. Right now, our generation's main like idea for Santa Claus is, oh, buy stuff all the time, and go around and down to people's chimneys and just give them stuff. That's what it's become.
Was Santa let into your house as a child, Harrison, or was it exclusively Hanukkah?
So I grew up Jewish, so there was no like Christmas thing happening so much. We had Hanukkah Jack. I guess it was.
No, Hanukkah Harry from SNL.
Hanukkah Jack.
But yeah, I guess it was just my parents. Like I knew. The beginning of the day. It's just my parents like trying to be nice, like for the whole like, oh, everyone else gets Christmas stuff, but here's seven presents. He's like eight presents, one for each day of Hanukkah.
We cannot compete this Christmas thing. Don't you worry, son.
But like,
actually, eight presents is a lot more than
there's
the
do not compete
Christmas. So.
Yeah, but, I mean, they weren't like my parents when I was growing up. My parents weren't rich or anything, so they were, you know, like small things. But I knew where they were coming from because I wasn't an idiot. And I was like, hey, it's cool. Thank you, Mom and Dad. You guys love me so much. And, you know, it was great.
Tyler, did you grow up with Santa Claus? Did they try to tell you that was a real thing?
I mean, it was just because they would interweave them with, like, the Mom and Dad gifts. But there would always be one gift from Santa. And it was just, it was fun to keep. And it was just because you could really get your kids excited on that day. And that's what some people are actually shopping for on Christmas holidays.
Yeah.
Like,
did they ever use it as a threat? Like,
what?
He wouldn't come.
No.
Oh, okay. Mine would.
No, that
was your There's some coal in your stockings.
You know what my dad used to do?
What's that?
He used to, like, you know, we'd be hanging out or whatever. He used to pretend like he saw an elf, like, you know, peeking into the window and then pretending not to be scared. Like, I just saw him. He's spying on you. Like, get the gun. He's watching
get
you.
The gun. It's like, you take out the kitchen knife. I'll be right back, Dad.
They even went so far as to actually... like print a letter back to me, like on actual paper that was like from Santa Claus.
What?
Yeah.
Damn.
Wow.
And like, you know, hi Sarah, it's Santa. Like the reindeer are good this year. Thanks for asking.
I remember as a little kid one time I spent the night over for Christmas at a friend's house. And he believed in Santa. That was we were little. We were like 8, 7, like 9 or whatever. He like a little bit late for him to still believe in Santa, I thought. Yeah. So he thought he would like be able to catch Santa and beat him up and steal all his presents. And I was like, okay, we'll stay up or whatever. I'm gonna watch TV. You can do that. And
no.
I was like, yeah. You're like a shitty little kid, but okay, I'm gonna watch TV. But you know.
I think Hannah and I would have been friends growing up.
I'm pretty sure Santa doesn't visit asshole kids like that.
Well, I don't know.
But I was there. I'm sure... No, wait. He doesn't visit Jews either.
Or cats who wait on other people's houses.
It's okay about that.
No, but I was introduced to the Tooth
oh,
Fairy. So I keep, like 7 years old, a lot of the Western culture and ritual are being introduced to me. including Santa Claus, so it's only validated, like, my father, parents were just liars, his father was a liar. He's like, he came to there, so, like, every morning after Christmas, I'm supposed to point at the fireplace, and that's where he came from. My brother David, though, and then he told me about the tooth fairy. If I put it underneath my pillow, this lady would come in there and give me money. And I was like, okay, all right, how big is this lady? He's like, it was very small, a little fairy. I was like, okay, got it. So, like, I had a trap set planned for this tooth fairy. I had a cage I would make under my bed. I had a container that I would trap the fairy in. And I would stay awake. I'd pretend I was asleep, listening to, like, a love line or something. And just being awake, just waiting and waiting and waiting. But eventually I'd fall asleep. And I'd wake, I mean, I would still be up till, like, maybe 3 o'clock, but after that, every single time, the new tooth comes out, trying to do the same thing, but I couldn't stay awake. And then there was a dollar, though, under my pillow, so I was very upset that the tooth fairy has got me. But then, of course, I once managed to open the door of my father's room, and I found, in a shut of drawers, all my baby teeth in there. Yeah.
And
so it's like, I knew it. I was like, oh, my God. Yeah. So...
got a jar waiting for you, old man.
Right. I got a beggar cage waiting for you now.
So I like it. Like, the whole thing, like, the celebration and the expression of, like, these different cultures and, like, these different things and where they come from. So people here in America are, for the mainstream, are familiar with Santa Claus. But I also remember, in addition to being Jewish, like, my family was, like, Hispanic, in Mexico, like, Santa Claus is kind of a thing, but not really. The really big thing in Mexico is the three wise men, and it's what the kids get the gifts from. It's not Saint Nick. It's the three wise men who, you know, visit baby Jesus and, like, give him the gift of myrrh, the gold, and the
cannabis and Bitcoin. Contemporary version,
right? That's who gives the gifts to the kids.
Yeah.
And I remember, like, my parents kind of telling me that story, but, like, not really. But I guess it was more, like, culturally significant, because, like, it's what it is. And each culture has, like, their own thing.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's great.
That is a big thing in Bolivia as well. Many of them don't have chimneys, so sometimes here in the United States, Santa Claus will, like, knock on your door and leave the presents there and disappear and run away.
Don't shoot!
Don't slay us up. Don't shoot.
Well, you run around the house checking.
Right, and so they do that. And so in Latino cultures, they open the present at midnight. Midnight is the time of opening all the presents. I guess the other half. I guess you open the presents in the morning. You guys leave out, like, cookies and.
It's actually, like, a weird thing. Like, when you choose to wake up, it's depending on whether or not how big of an asshole you are. And, like, you'll wait for your parents to make breakfast, and that's usually, like, 9 o'clock. 9 o'clock is a good time to wake up for Christmas. That's straight up the cul-de-sac.
Well, once the great disillusionment happens, you sort of, like, have to sit there waiting. Like, I have to be polite because I want to keep getting presents.
So I have to write this letter. Oh, my God, dear Santa.
Yeah. But I find it really interesting, like, you know, what the representations of these figures are in the cultures. It's like in Mexico and most of Latin America, the three wise men, they're most closely related with the birth of Jesus and,
right,
like, and with the Catholic religion. Most people, they're Catholic, and it's that significant to them that that's the thing that they celebrate. Here, like, I guess our Santa Claus is all related to buying shit. So,
ooh, but Saint Nicholas is related to, and I don't know if the Randy in the news is going to come out and bite me, but he's altruism. Because he was a bishop,
really?
Who threw money into the window of less fortunate people. So, do you
money
feel
that,
this is a bad
other people gave
socialist
him, though, right?
Thing?
Bad socialist thing? No, not at all. Again, like Halloween or anything else, or when I believe in leprechauns or tooth fairies, as long as there's a... You don't want to encourage the child not to believe in his own senses and his own intuition. I think there should be some kind of line drawn in to encourage the child to separate the fantasy and reality. You don't want to handicap the child growing up, I guess, in that regards. But you can still make it fun and be part of it. You can still celebrate the rituals.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, I mean, the pervasive thing through all religions is that there are certain things you don't look upon. You know, like, there's certain books you don't look at when you... I mean, correct me if I'm wrong here. You know, there's things you look away from in all religions. You avert your eyes from that you're not supposed to see. You know, even dead pagan religions. You know, there's statues that they keep veiled and all that. So to... to take a leap of faith and not make an effort to hunt down and kill Santa Claus for all his presents is something that, you know, they kind of teach children. Like, it's something you don't question. And that is a huge tool of the state.
You also have to remember, like a lot of these traditions and all of these stories over time become kind of like moral stories. And like the word is used moral stories back in the day. Like telling kids, don't be bad, or, you know, bad shit's gonna happen to you because of this story. Ooh. And the kid's like, oh, that really happened. Turns out our brains, whenever we read a narrative, or when someone's talking to us, like something is a narrative, our brain like processes that happening differently than how we experience reality. It's
like a childhood suspension of disbelief, it's more real?
It's not like a suspension of disbelief, it's more like, this happened, this was a thing, and you're going to encode this as something that has happened and that could happen. So it's
an actual life experience, but not really.
Yeah, it's like a life experience by proxy. When we know that something's a story, it's like we've proxied that experience. So it's like, it's weird, it's cool, but that's why it works. That's why stories like work as like these vehicles to convey moral beliefs. And that's why it's always been done, because it's just been effective.
It would be different if it was only a story, though.
Yeah, so...
And instead, parents use it to manipulate their children and to get things like false respect
and
fear.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the intention. It's like the intention to use with it, like, with the families that, like, use it, like, as a unity type kind of thing. Like, you have families that are together and spend time and have that bond. With families that use it manipulatively.
But still, even to use it as, like, bond and not even be honest, like, it is just the story.
Well, I mean, my family was honest with me about, like, Santa Claus. They're like, oh, like, this
from
is
the
what
beginning.
The culture
did they ever
is.
Tell you about Boogeyman?
No. And then, like, and even then, like, with the Jewish stuff, like, we know why we do Hanukkah. We know why we have the celebrations. Like, we have like,
oil
the textbooks. It's all historical stuff. And they're like, oh, this happened, and this is why we do this. And it's like, oh, okay, that seems really, like, religious, but I do like drinking wine as a little kid. Awesome. You know, I grew up drinking wine forever, so it's like, I love Jewish traditions.
Did you get to drink it at Passover, too?
Oh, always.
What about Purim? I hear that's a big drunk.
Purim is,
okay.
Of course. Purim is like the party night.
I'm a little jealous, because, you know, like, seriously, uber Orthodox people will come into the shop and be like, yeah, we're going to drink so much. I'm like, you? Your black knee socks?
Yeah, it's like commanded. Like, you will celebrate with drinking.
Right.
So, speaking of, like, fables, I looked up one. Which was the fox and the
crow. Oh,
yeah. What is
a
story?
That video.
Enlighten us.
All right. So there was this crow, and he found a piece of cheese. And he flew up into the branch to eat his piece of cheese. And the fox came along and decided to be clever and said, hey, crow, beautiful crow, your voice must be just as beautiful. And the crow squawked, and the cheese dropped. And the fox ate it and laughed and walked away.
It's funny, they have a lot of myth stories of crows always being the creator of the world. Sneaky crows, sneaky creatures, like very Prometheus-like creatures who inadvertently help create civilization.
Carrying wings under their fire under their wings.
Yeah.
So that story was brought to you by the Nevermore Anarchy Garden.
Ooh.
Thank you.
Have some cheese.
I feel like this is like Food Rainbow. When you're around.
So other than that, with Santa Claus, if I ever have children, yeah, I'm not going to tell them that this thing's a real man. So, hey, it's a fun thing to do, but for me, like when I was a kid, like for Thanksgiving, sometimes they'll ask me to give thanks. Or sometimes around the table. And so I would give thanks, or thank you for everyone to come here at this table. Thank you for those who worked the 9 to 5 jobs and bring the food here, and those who bring that to the table. And I remember having an uncle, it's like, y Dios? It's like, and God? It's like, I'm just thanking anyone who's here right now in this community here, in this room. So, and that's so much like when I was a kid, my father would try to tell me, hey, it's your uncle's birthday. You say happy birthday. He's talking to him on the phone. It's like, look, I don't know the guy. Like, you want me to pretend? Because I'm not going to pretend that I'm happy. You know, to say, exclaim happy birthday. And it's like, Cal's not here right now. I liked being honest with that sort of stuff. And I think a lot of this stuff could, in a way, take away from those who I guess you should be, if you're going to say thanks to, be thankful, or at least include those people.
That's what we're talking about religion, are we?
Well, yeah, we're not talking about religion. I'm just talking about capitalism. Unless Herzog wants to talk about religion, of course, but in terms of, for me,
oh,
I just
what?
Like to be...
but I can't talk about
oh, yeah.
Okay.
Unless anyone else wants to talk about religion, I mean, I probably have the most to say.
I've been
the
looking
most
up the most...
Well,
religious.
I was an acolyte.
Well,
I want to talk about atheism.
You want to talk about atheism?
I mean, if you want to talk about how to be religious at being atheist...
Actually,
about...
I just want to talk about how crazy I think religious people are.
Yeah.
Just from my perspective.
I mean, I'll agree with you. Like, there's a lot of things
If anybody believed, like, there was a magical moose god and decided to walk around telling people they needed, like, oh, this moose god is real and he will, you know, he determines whether or not your afterlife is good and happy and fun or you burn in fires for all eternity, we need your money. And we're going to build some of the biggest, most beautiful architectural centers you've ever seen. More than you could ever afford to live in. So, you know, we're going to essentially frauding people. For my opinion, it's all a massive fraud. I wanted to have this conversation with my mother specifically for some time. I know she'll never watch this video, so I'm not afraid to say it. But... just from my perspective, if you could see how crazy, like, I mean, from an atheist perspective, how legitimately insane people that are religious seem or, like, come across, like, the actions, the decisions they make defies rationality.
You say you come
and
from
most people would just say, oh, okay, well, you're an atheist, okay. It's like, well, you don't have to understand.
But you came from a background.
Like, at Thanksgiving,
like
they prayed. My mom's like, you don't have to say anything, just, like, let's just hold hands. And I'm like... I mean, you're acting crazy in front of me, and you're asking me to look the other way, but, like, you don't want to, like, even consider my point of view, or how, like,
yeah.
this seems to me, and how insulting it is for, like, I mean, the family not crazy, right?
And
expect me to be totally okay with it.
I find that people, like, I feel like a lot of people tend to, and this seems to happen a lot, like, within religious communities, and with religious people, like, they tend to, like, want to know only what they want to know, and then they're fine with being, like, blissfully ignorant about a few things, as long as it doesn't, like, mess with what they believe. For whatever reason, I find, like, most people who really believe incredibly strongly, they believe in a very human way. We look at things from our perspective. People in the past used to look at nature and say, oh man, the wind must be a god, because it moves shit, and I can't see how it's doing it. But you can feel the wind. They don't know where it comes from. And if you think about that in oversimplified ways, like, you come away with a bad understanding of what wind actually is. And same thing with a higher power. If a higher power exists, or there's, like, an intentionality, meaning, or control, or whatever, it's probably not, like, a guy commanding everything in the sky. It's some kind of underlying pattern. But that's because I've approached it from, like, a scientific perspective, or, like, trying to find... what is this pattern that repeats? But that's how I come away at it. But a lot of religious people, they come from a very declarative style where people have done all the thinking for them. They read a book, they don't question it, they just read black and white, and then they go and just do that, what it says.
And they think it's totally acceptable for them, but as soon as other people do it in a different way, they think they're totally batshit crazy,
yeah.
And they have no problem calling
like,
them on it.
The reason why it doesn't happen too much in Judaism is because Judaism is all about having opinions. They're like, read this text, what do you think it means? What do you think it means? Now argue about it and figure out other meanings. That's you grow up that way in a lot of Jewish places, and you have all this
Islam has
1,000
clerics too. It's only the violent ones we hear about, you know.
and for the Buddhists out there,
what?
Is that their buttocks?
No.
Buddhists
are already atheists. They don't believe that God exists.
Yeah.
So they're like, they're already a spiritual movement, but they're atheists.
I think the most difficult one of a spirituality that would be contending with would be in Japan, in which they have a belief of Shintoism, have strict adherence to ancestral worship. So it seems to be more strict adherence to authoritative control then. Not to question it, not to go against their wishes. And that would be interesting in how at some point they spread anarchy there. even though they have the Ronin.
It's socialized. You will be taken care of in the afterlife. You know, you will get what you deserve. You'll get another chance. You know,
right, just like
the fact that you are wretched in this rice paddy is what you're meant to be.
As an atheist, religion doesn't bother me much. Rituals, stories.
Religion doesn't bother me. It's the people that.
Right, right. So I was separate as.
Vodka is the opiate of the masses for stuff.
You could believe that. Like I have nothing against stories of
people. That force those ideas.
Exactly, and that's the point.
Awesome.
That's the point where I go to. So like. If you want to, I have nothing against stories that people want to believe that there was a guy who walked in water into wine. That sounds awesome. No more than someone wants to believe in the eye Saruman controls everyone. Sounds pretty cool and sees all. Whatever, you know, as long as it's voluntary, consensual, as long as those have the freedom to disassociate if they wanted to and check out another community. I'll probably have a timeshare in that Lord of the Rings community.
And let's face it, most things we believe scientifically, I can't quantify them myself. I believe it because I've heard it on TV programs and read it in articles and shit like that. You know, I mean, I'm taking things on faith every day.
And there's other levels of thought. Like, you can know one thing to be fact from scientific, knowing it scientifically, but even in the realm of philosophy, like, we know what we ought to be doing, or we could come up with an argumentative way of discovering what ought we do when we know a thing or want to believe something to be true, and how should that impact how I interact with other people? Should I be a virtuous, kind, loving person, or should I be, you know, a belligerent asshole telling you that you need to do this? Obviously, it's the first thing and not the former. But people don't know their own religion enough to understand that that's what's trying to be fostered. They're ignorant, and it's terrible.
So what's the opportunity cost? Like, how much are you losing out by having these beliefs or doing these set behaviors?
Really? I would say you're missing out on a hell of a
lot. I don't know. A lot of people have. For people, this
well, religion teaches people not to separate abstract and concrete concepts. So now they believe in things that they can't actually feel or touch. They believe that it literally exists. So then they'll make excuses for stuff like government.
But what they provide, what government doesn't provide, would be cohesion, community, I guess, support.
You don't need a religion to do that, though.
So I'm not saying you do need
it. I know,
but
you're saying, he's asking
saying,
how much people would miss out.
I'm saying what they do provide and what they're providing is that.
So it's one solution that provides some of that. But they're many of other solutions that could also provide analogous things. Because
these things that you're saying could exist without religion. So.
Absolutely. But I'm saying, I'm trying to look at the healthy stuff that they provide now in the absence of government, because government doesn't provide that. And support systems. Sure.
So it's like,
as long as like these ideas, at least the foundational thing, like going back to what you were saying, is those ideas, people who violently force their ideas onto others.
And like that our support systems for each other don't like encourage I mean, you might think they're a support system in a community, but they're not a healthy one. I mean, from my point of view,
Right.
So Jesus was actually approached about taxes, and he picked up a coin that had Caesar's face on it. He said, "Give to Caesar what is Caesar, and give to God what is God's." Everyone at that moment was like, "Okay, so everything's God's. God owns everything." But it was really, he was holding up like 10%, and he was like, "I want 10% on top of this."
Mm-hmm.
We didn't say
but like, think of it that way. Like, if he could start a Ponzi scheme, I'll start one right here.
I've also heard of other contentions saying that perhaps that it was made up by Roman aristocrats to encourage Judaism to pay their taxes. Because they always have talked about a prophet, and this would be an interesting concoction to kind of bring those stories to life and create a character that says, "Render Caesar's to what it says, pay your taxes, you know. If he slaps you in the face, take it on the other side. Be pacifist. Don't resist.
Well,
don't
that's,
that's
not
act
exactly what that one means. But yeah.
Well, I'm just saying these are interesting stories I've come across. So trying to explain that one example.
So when you tithe, do you tithe out of your gross or your net? That's a pretty big difference.
So from what I've understood, it's supposed to be actually from your gross.
It is from your gross.
Yeah.
But if it was taxed, it would be from your net. You taxed on tax on tax.
Tax on tax.
Double tax. It is a double tax.
And the thing
I feel bad for it because I see all these beautiful churches and I see like homeless people. And it's like there's so many buildings unoccupied.
You know, what's funny
and there's just so many people
is,
not occupying them.
Like and this is just like a small thing like and the whole way the tithing system works, it's supposed to be first to the poor or the widow and the orphan in your community, and then the temple, or then like the Levites. But the priority of that community was people who need help, like are needy, and Like, back in the day, back then, they were totally sexist about who could fight in wars. They were like, only men and young men. So they would have an overabundance of, like, widowed women
with
kids.
Well, even then, how do you find people that need help? Because there's a lot of people that need help that's not monetary help.
Like, back in the day, it was all about communities. So you would have to be in touch with the community to, like, make it around.
Like the fraternities of friends societies and mutual aid societies.
And if you were a woman who was independently earning money, you weren't seen as worthy of being seen by the church as a worthy person. So,
not in Hebrew culture. In Hebrew culture, actually, like,
what is the Israeli stance on prostitutes?
it's inch
off of the head.
It's not legal per se, but some people don't care. That's pretty much the stance. I mean, you go to Tel Aviv, you can probably find a prostitute pretty easily.
Ooh. Tel Aviv, the Vegas of Israel.
I'm sorry, this is PC, sex worker.
Okay.
Okay.
Prostitute is better than whore.
Oh, no. There's this contention out there.
Israel also, unfortunately, also has, like, it's also a tax farm. They have their own government. They're more socialist than, way super socialist. And they're also, like, all military and stuff, but...
Okay, well, I just view them as, like, you know, the, how should we say, the reformed Old Testament Judaism, you know? I mean, like, what is the new stance on these certain walks of life? So that's why I asked you, because you've been there.
In Tel Aviv, the people who live there, they're okay with, like, pretty much, like, oh, you want to do stuff? That's cool. As long as you're not hurting me, go ahead. In Jerusalem, you have the more religious crowd who are like, oh no, this shouldn't be allowed, or blah, blah, blah. But it's a difference in the cities. You know, Tel Aviv is, like, new and modern, and, like, modern Hebrew city, and, like, people there, as long as you're not, you know, aggressing against them, they're like, do whatever. It's great.
Makes it sound like Italians a little bit.
Yeah. Man, just eat the pasta.
Feed me.
All right, nice. Well, I think that's a good Santa Claus little wrap.
What are we going to talk about for the next couple of weeks?
No. Yeah, we will. We will. We have until Christmas.
The enslavement of reindeers.
All right.
animal.
Elves is the proletariat, yes.
Poor children. So we have one thing. You said you wanted to bring up one interesting discussion on finals. So want to bring that up?
Yeah. So now, like, probably everyone who's, like, in college is going to, like, finals this week. But I just kind of want to bring up, like, what your opinions are on, like... So, traditionally, universities are supposed to be seen as, like, places of free thought. People can come and discuss things that they want to learn. It's supposed to be centers of higher learning. But I find it, like, perplexing. Like, you have public universities and you have, like, completely private ones. The public, like, do you think that, how much influence do you think, like, the state system has on the professors and what they're, like, teaching the next generation of people growing up? People who are, you know, going to be getting jobs, going to be being the lifeblood of the economy of the world. Like, the influence that these professors have, do you think it perpetuates the system?
Yeah, absolutely. I don't think they have much control on a lot of them, especially in public schools. They don't have a lot of control. I think you were mentioning that our philosopher friend, English professor, you want to share that story when he was sharing with you last time?
I don't really remember.
Like, he was trying to have this after class room activity for the students.
Before class.
And he was trying to encourage thought and encouraging them to ask questions. And then, like, the teachers pulled him aside. So, like, you can't do that anymore. Like, it says supervisors.
No. During class, you can't teach what free thought is.
What?
But he had a place before school started where kids could come and talk. He couldn't direct them with questions. He was not allowed. But he just provided space for them to talk about stuff.
That's ridiculous. You can't even do that?
Because technically he'd be leading them, like, to be more, like, lenient with his philosophy, which, you know, they don't want children to sort of think for themselves.
So this was, like, a public school?
Yes.
Yeah, so,
and they,
like,
would have brought up the hemlock.
Right. And again, remember, university level, I deal a lot with socialist teachers who would tell you, like, you know, this is the only system you have, this is the only monopoly law you have. But in terms of like how you bring up these subjects, you can approach them. And I've had several teachers who understood anarchy and was supportive of it, and after classes in our private discussions. And I've met some teachers who, the way that they reacted and talked to students just upset me enough to just be an asshole to them instead for the rest of the semester. And I've already shared the story about that one teacher who was commanding the students to stand at attention when they enter the room. Did I tell you that one?
Yes.
Yeah.
After I shared that. And there's also one in which someone brought in a guest speaker of a police nature. She was an investigator to the class and was sharing what the job is like. And then, of course, she's laughing about what she already called a victimless crime of putting people, prostitutions, and people who consumers of that into jail and laughing about it and sharing funny stories. She's trying to say that they're funny and people are laughing. And then I raised my hand and said, well, how do you feel about, because you're laughing now, so how do you feel about putting, you know, dehumanizing these people and by throwing them into these cages when you kidnap them for what you call a victimless crime, quote unquote. And then she got angry and she started, you know, walking towards me, you know, opening her jacket, her guns in view, what you will see in a threatening manner, I'm sitting in the back and she's approaching me, trying to say, well, it prevents diseases off the street. And it's like trying to do a lot of false arguments. And the teacher's letting this go on. And I said, well, this is great. I love arguing, so let's do this. And the teacher's like, can I stop? It's like, no, I'm not stopping. Obviously, if she wants to continue, I will continue to argue back. And then the teacher ordered me to get out of the classroom. And I said, which is a fault on her because she invited someone else that came at me threatening it should be her that books will be leaving because I'm paying for these classes.
Yeah, you only
right?
pay her salary.
Right, you're not paying attention. She's coming at me in a threatening manner. She's no longer should be
you
in this environment.
Why
did
you say that?
It was probably
like
because
that,
you
wait a minute.
Right, at that time, I wasn't thinking that until I left the classroom. Matt reminded me of that. Eichler. And so later on, did talk to the teacher and got
you
her.
You just say, no, wait a minute, I'm the customer.
Right. Right.
This person
now,
is.
I'm the one who should be feeling unsafe. You should get her out of here. This is not a safe environment when you have your guests coming at your students and your customers in a threatening manner, right? Because she's a cop, please. Because it's a costume and the title that throws them off.
She probably would have assaulted you.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
If she's given a chance,
yeah.
I'm sure. Yeah, just like the other people.
So that was like
a
diffusion
of
the whole situation.
Right.
Nothing personal then.
But yeah, and the teacher didn't do anything to stop that. So like when you're mentioning earlier, what kind of capacity they have now, they all seem to be, most of them have been slaves to it and to perpetuate that. And I think that is one area in which we have, I feel, personally, I focus a lot on because that's the academic center. That's where they instill a lot of these socialist propaganda into the minds of those who are growing to be the higher management in the business world.
Yeah,
right?
I feel like when I was there, I came away with a sense, and I guess I went through it from more of the science side from chemistry and biology.
Mm-hmm.
But I very much felt more like the inculcation of the idea, like, oh, government, you need it. More, it didn't really come up until you start thinking about research, because you need a lot of research in public universities is funded by government grants or research grants. Some of it's privately owned research funded by private companies, but you don't hear about that. Like, it's very hard to get in contact or to know people who want to do it because it's usually like for some kind of application research. Usually that's what they hire engineers to do and figure out how to do. But I feel very much once you talk to like the professors at a graduate level, or you're doing any kind, or if you're an undergrad and you want to do research with them, I feel like it's always contingent on them, like, oh, like if I get the good grant money, that would be great. And I feel like they're dependent in that way. In academic circles, it's very much publish or perish. Like if they don't publish enough papers or do enough stuff, like they will lose like their spot at that university. But I feel like it's really that's my feeling with that, and I wish there was a more of a way we could take away that dependence on public or government grants, and you know, make it easier, like you know how like Kickstarter.
You have to like end intellectual property.
Yeah, I think IP is a big part of that as well.
Because people would just say, well, technically I own this, so if you want to publish a study on it, I need to approve it.
But essentially,
and if it goes against me, oh, sorry, you can't publish this.
Like, I think it would be cool if, like, people started using Kickstarter for, like, research grants, for research stuff. That would be cool. I would totally.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's not a lot of real research and development that comes out of the socialistic framework.
I think they should build the roads. I think we should put, like, strips of roads on Kickstarter. We will do this overnight, paved, done, painted.
Mm-hmm.
Because, like, everyone's like, what about the roads? It's like, privatize the roads.
I'll fill your potholes.
So if you live in that community and you did donate, like, you would realize that everyone drives on the roads, and there's plenty of people that are willing. You won't need tolls. Toll roads won't exist.
Dude, you could make... You don't even need to, like, say where the road's going to be. What you could make is make a Kickstarter idea. Like, hey, we want a road in this community. People who are in that community would be like, hey, we want this. They would get together and decide where the best place to put the road would be, and that would be the road. Dude, that's a great approach. Kickstarter roads?
The only problem is if it's not actually owned by anyone, anyone could homestead it. So they could immediately just be like, well, it's mine. Like,
right, exactly. It's not
so
owned.
Really, it would have to be privately owned. But, like, if
get a community ownership there.
I don't feel like there would be a lot of tools.
We would figure something out, but at the very least, the Kickstarter could be a way to fund it easily.
Yeah, especially if you got big ass potholes.
We could definitely figure out, like, how ownership and stuff would work.
Next one. Right. Mm. So, let's do that. So, that's a good wrap up for the discussion here. Thank you guys for watching. Thank you guys for coming out. So with that, we'll continue. You guys have any topics or discussion suggestions that you'd like for us to go over, put in the comment section below. And with that,
if there's somebody you'd like to see us drinking, please.
Right. So with that, thank you for watching. See you guys at Victory Party and Liberate RVA.
Liberate RVA!